Let's worship together, First Assembly. Lift your voice with us.
Jesus, your love has come one step closer. I will trust you will never let me go. Jesus, your love has won me over all my trust, has found no other.
Sing it out.
And I will declare the beauty of the Lord. Nothing compares beauty of the Lord. Jesus, your love takes my breath away. Now I'm living every day for the beauty of the Lord.
Living for the beauty of the Lord.
Say, Jesus, your love. Jesus, your love has come one step closer. I will trust that you will never let me go.
Never let me go. Jesus, your love.
Jesus, your love has won me over all my trust, has found no other.
And I will
declare the beauty of the Lord. Nothing compares to the beauty of the Lord. Your love, it takes my breath away. Jesus, your love, it takes my breath away. Jesus, your love, it takes my breath away. Jesus, your love, it takes my breath away.
Sing it out.
Now I'm living every day for the beauty.
beauty of the Lord. Hey. Hallelujah.
Higher,
it's deep,
it's deep. Can we worship the Lord for a moment this morning in His house? Lord, we say thank You. Your grace, it amazes us, God. It still blows us away. Lord, it's what makes us want to get up on a Sunday morning and start church an hour early and go do things and see people and engage. Your grace has affected us. We make this confession, Lord, that a person can never truly come into contact with Your grace and walk away the same that they were before that encounter. Your grace is amazing. God, we thank You that You did not just leave us the way we were, that You don't just leave us the way we are, but God, that You come to us and You engage us and You heal us. You put us back together. You forgive us. You challenge us. You grow us. Your grace gives us the strength we need for every journey we walk through. Lord, it's with that in mind this morning that we pray for the needs of the people of this body, those who are in the room this morning, those who are watching, those who can do neither right now but are hurting or are in pain or are recovering, people that are recovering from surgeries and people who are recovering from illness, some who aren't really recovering from illness yet but are just kind of getting started on that journey. But God, we recognize that Your grace keeps, Your grace heals, Your grace gives strength. So God, we ask You to apply all of those things in every need affecting our body and in our community this morning, God. God, every family that we're going to encounter in the next hour to an hour and a half, God, I pray that Your grace would go before us. God, go before us. Soften hearts, God. Soften our hearts as we go. But meet the needs of the people, God. We thank You for it all. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. You may be seated. Good morning, First Assembly. Happy Independence Day to you. We celebrate 245 years as a nation today, tracking back to July 4th, maybe even really July 2nd, but July 4th, 1776. And today's going to be a great day of service. We're going to demonstrate our freedom to worship the Lord how we see fit by going into our community and meeting people, engaging people the same way that Jesus did, the same way that Jesus does. He just does it through us now. And so to celebrate this morning, I wanted to draw your attention to the monitors and check out this letter from John Adams to his, it was the original Dear Abby letter. Watch this.
The long, laborious debate in the walls of the Continental Congress finally comes to an end. They have voted, they have declared independence from Great Britain. And that night by candlelight, John Adams writes an emotional letter to his beloved Abigail. Speaking of Independence Day, he writes, "This day will be
the most memorable epoch in the history of America. I'm apt to believe it will be celebrated by succeeding generations as the great anniversary festival. It ought to be commemorated as a day of deliverance by solemn acts of devotion to God Almighty. It ought to be solemnized with pomp and parade, with shows, games, sports, guns, bells, bonfires, and illuminations from one end of this continent to the other, from this time forward forevermore. I am well aware of the toil and blood and treasure that it will cost us to maintain this declaration. Yet, through all the gloom, I can see the rays of ravishing light and glory. I can see that the end is more than worth all the means. But I must submit all my hopes and fears to an overruling providence in which, unfashionable as the faith may be, I firmly believe."
May we never forget that we are a people who have been delivered from tyranny to liberty, from oppression to freedom, from fear to courage. And today, above all days, may we renew our personal devotion to the giver of all liberty.
Can you say amen? I'm going to ask the ushers to come this morning and we'll allow you to worship in your giving. It's still a worship day. Still the first day of the week. I don't know who said that amen, but it's, I appreciate that.
Yeah.
Still the first day of the week. Lord, bless this offering. We joyfully bring our gifts to you. Thank you for sustaining us in our lives and work in such a powerful way. We love you. And it is our joy to bring this to you each Sunday, or however often we get paid, or whenever we bring it, but it's our joy to bring it in worship in this way. Use these gifts, Lord, I pray, to announce more fully the kingdom of God, and we thank you for it in Jesus' name. Amen. And the Declaration of Independence, 245 years ago, 128 years ago, Catherine Bates wrote these words, and this has just always been one of my favorites, and I had asked Pastor Derwin if he might look at it and do something with it for us today. But, oh, beautiful for spacious skies, for amber waves of grain, for purple mountain majesties above the fruited plain. America, America, God shed his grace on thee and crown thy good with brotherhood from sea to shining sea. Aren't those lyrics incredible? Oh, beautiful for heroes proved in liberating strife. Heroes proved in liberating strife, who more than self their country loved, and mercy more than life. America, America, may God thy gold refine, till all success be nobleness and every gain divine. She wrote this beautiful plea. It's a prayer, really, asking God for his blessing. Shed your grace on us, God. Shed your grace on us. Recognizing that the grace of God is this most incredible blessing, but it is also that same grace with which we are blessed. That's the grace that gives us the strength to do the right things. That's the grace that holds us accountable. That's the grace that refines our gold, that refines us, makes us better. So I knew you wouldn't mind, but I wanted to see if Pastor Derwin would lead us in a couple of verses of this song. It's, some have called it the national hymn. Not the national anthem, but the national hymn. And so, if you will, why don't you stand and sing it? We won't be here long today. You get your blood moving.
Oh, beautiful for spacious skies, for amber waves of grain, for purple mountains majesties above the fruited plain. America, America, God shed his grace on thee and crown thy good by human tears.
You may be seated. Thank you, Pastor Derwin. That is worth taking some time for that, for sure. It's 9:53 by my watch, so we've got 7 minutes. I've got a yard to mow over in Ambercrest. And I was tempted to wear my shorts this morning, just like some of you carnal ones. But I didn't feel like you were ready for that. And what this camera would capture was just not time. So the conversationalist. Jesus was a conversationalist. John chapter 3, he talked to Nicodemus at night, a Pharisee of all people. John chapter 4, Jesus talks to the Samaritan woman at the well. It's where we were last. He engaged them. He stopped. Not just did he stop, but he went out of his way to see them, to engage them. And that's what we're getting ready to do here in just a very few minutes. If you tuned in earlier, or you're tuning in at 10:30, and somehow the service was well past what you thought it should be, it's because this is a day of service for us. Scatter and serve. Youth, our students, you guys alive to serve. That's a phrase you already know. Yeah. There was a side conversation in John chapter 4 that we read last week, and I'm going to read it again. We didn't stop to examine it last week. We didn't focus there. But I want to read it and hear what Jesus says to them and to us. And I'm reading to you this morning from the New Living Translation because I loved how it flowed in that translation. John chapter 4, verse 31 says, "Meanwhile, the disciples..." Okay, let me back up. Jesus, a Jewish man, was talking to this Samaritan woman. So the math doesn't work in several ways already. He had had no lunch. The disciples were mystified by the fact that Jesus was skipping lunch. I get it. They didn't really want to confront Jesus about it. So they had questions, but they didn't want to engage him to ask. But they didn't get it. But they were trying to get him to eat. So that's where we pick up. "Meanwhile, the disciples were urging Jesus, 'Rabbi, eat something.' But Jesus replied, 'I have a kind of food you know nothing about.'" Doesn't this remind you of Jesus in the wilderness? He'd been fasting for 40 days, and the accuser came to him and said, "Command that these stones be made bread." And Jesus said to him, "It is written that man should not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God." This is not the first time that Jesus has found a different kind of food that the disciples did not yet understand. Or with the woman at the well just a few minutes prior to this, when he was saying, "If you understood what kind of water I have, you'd be asking me for water instead of me asking you for water." Spiritual meat and drink to the disciples. "I have a kind of food you know nothing about." Verse 33. "Did someone bring him food while we were gone?" the disciples asked each other. Then Jesus explained, "My nourishment comes from doing the will of God who sent me and from finishing his work." It's as simple as that. I'm driven by divine purpose. My food is doing the will of God and finishing his work. There was another place where Jesus said, "I see where the Father's at work, and I join him in his work." We just participate in his work with him. My food is doing the will of God and finishing his work. And some of us are going to experience that in just the next few minutes. You're going to come back for hamburgers and hot dogs, but you're going to care very little about those hamburgers and hot dogs compared to what you have already eaten, not in this service, but in your service that follows in the next few minutes. My food is doing the will of God and finishing his work. Then Jesus said this, verse 35, "You know the saying, 4 months between planting and harvest, but I say, wake up and look around. The fields are already ripe for harvest. The harvesters are paid good wages, and the fruit they harvest is people brought to eternal life. What joy awaits both the planter and the harvester alike." Jesus is saying 4 months between plant. That's like hitting the snooze button on your alarm. Anybody hit snooze this morning? Just one time? And just come on, let me see the hands. Yeah. Man, those of you who did not hit snooze, I do not understand you at all. But that snooze button, it used to always be 9 minutes. But you know, it's like, well, I'm okay. I don't have to get up now because I've got another 9 minutes. You know, now, you know, if you're using your phone or your watch or whatever, you can set it. the time, but I've got this much more time. I don't have to move yet. I've still got a few more minutes. And Jesus is saying to the disciples that same thing. He said, you guys are hitting the snooze button. He literally says, wake up. Wake up and look around. The fields are ripe. They're ready. That really just means the people are ready. These conversations we're getting ready to have, these encounters we're getting ready to have this morning, the people are ready to have those conversations. They are ready. And Jesus is saying, don't hit the snooze button again. Don't wait. Amber waves of grain. Think about the Bible. Jesus is making this reference. Please, when we sing Amber Waves of Grain, don't just think about Kansas. It is Kansas. And I have driven all the way across Kansas from one end to the other before. And it is like an ocean of land, all of this grain. But it's Amber Crest over here. This neighborhood that's right beside, just their property just about touches our property. Right over, it's your neighborhood. It's the people that you encounter. They are ready for these conversations. They're ready for these encounters with us. They're ready, they're ready, they're ready. And Jesus is saying, wake up and look around. And I love that it says right in the passage, the fruit they harvest is people brought to eternal life. That's the fruit. What joy for the planter and the harvester alike. Verse 37, you know the saying, one plants and another harvests, and it's true. I sent you to harvest where you didn't plant. Others had already done the work, and now you will get to gather the harvest. You will get to gather. So we don't go because we have to today. We go because we get to. We get to harvest. We get to gather. So there are some You Are Amazing cards out there on the round table. I told you about them last week. They're about 4 inches by 4 inches square, just a single card front and back. It's got our church website on there. If you're comfortable where you are, for the one that I have, I'm probably going to write my name and phone number on it for the person I'm handing it to. And if they need me, they can. Don't feel pressure to do that. You may not even need to give it out, but it's there for you. You may want to grab if there are a few of those Right Now Media cards left. It's like a free subscription to Netflix. I mean, it's just full of stuff. It's something you can give them. But grab a You Are Amazing card, grab a Right Now Media card. Let's pray. Lord, we trust you. We love you. Thank you so much for allowing us to join you in your work this morning. God, we just make this confession. We say and believe that we will not just walk out of here to mow grass and pick up trash and talk to people and vacuum or whatever it is that we're doing. We're not just going like that, but we're going in the power with the unction of the Holy Spirit undergirding us, with the Holy Spirit going before us. Lord, do incredible, miraculous spiritual things today through the hands and feet and the hearts and minds of the people of this church. And we thank you for it. We love you for it. In Jesus' name, amen. Will you stand? And can we make this confession from Psalm 19:14 that we make every week? May the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, my strength and my redeemer. Pastor Derwin's going to be in here to lead some, to continue with a time of worship. For those who cannot go, if you can't scatter and serve, you can just stay and pray. He'll be in here to provide some cover there. There may be, if you're watching online, there may be just a few minutes of transition as we kind of get where we need to be. But we love you. If you're watching, I love you guys. It's 10:02. Get out of here. Let's go get it done.